Dorothy Thompson was the first affirmative action director at Kansas State University. And let me just mention a personal memory. She was as near an absolutist on the rights of free speech, the First Amendment, as I know. However, she also, in her capacity as university attorney, helped draft the first hate speech ordinance here at the university. Fairness and honesty in discussion were her hallmarks. And as a result, this is a piece of her commitment to civil rights. Thus, this civil rights lecture series is a worthy and appropriate recognition of her contributions, her many contributions to Kansas State University. Tonight, the lecture or debate discussion is on civil rights and same-sex marriage. Mr. Pedro Irigonegaray, a civil rights attorney, will be advocating for the expansion of these rights. Mr. Joel Oster, a senior attorney at the Alliance Defense Fund, will argue the opposing view. Mr. Irigonegaray is a civil rights attorney in Topeka, having graduated from the Washburn Law School. Mr. Oster also has a Kansas connection, having graduated from the University of Kansas Law School. Our moderator tonight is Professor Bill Rich, an associate dean and professor on the Faculty of Law at Washburn University, who will now outline the ground rules for the debate and discussion. Once again, welcome. I hope we all enjoy the evening.
Thank you, Larry. And before I begin, let me just say that it's a real privilege to be here participating, particularly in the Dorothy Thompson Lecture Series. I remember Dorothy well as one of my students at Washburn Law School. And as we think about her and think about the discussion that we're going to have together tonight, it seems to me that one of the things to keep in mind is that as we hear the various strong arguments sometimes about strong feelings people have, and sometimes referring to abstract theories and legal doctrine, Dorothy would want us to also remember that when we're addressing these issues, we're talking about real people, too. And it's the people side of all of this that I think we'll keep in mind, at least in some sense, as we think about Dorothy and think about this lecture series. It's also worth noting that this is a particularly appropriate time for this particular debate, because it was exactly 1 year ago, on April 5th, 2005, that Kansas adopted a same-sex marriage amendment, which in turn is part of what triggers the need for ongoing discussion of these issues. One of the things that I particularly appreciate is that a year later, there are still significant numbers of people who are interested in this debate and interested in the discussion that's going to follow. Let me very quickly outline the rules of the debate. Both of the participants will be given seven minutes in which to introduce the topic and their perspective on the topic. Following that, I will be asking them a series of questions that I have planned in advance and that I gave both of them just a few moments ago. I'll go back and forth between them. Each one will have 3 minutes to respond to the question. The other will have 3 minutes to respond to the response, and then I'll give one more minute for a final response before we get on to the next question. I intend to ask five or six questions depending on how time goes. The reason why I may cut it short is because we want to be sure that there is some time for all of you to ask questions if you have them. At a particular point in the proceedings, I will let you know that now would be a good time to go back into the corner of the room where there are a couple of students, their hands are raised. They were raised. They have cards that you can write out questions on, and we'll do this in time so that they can in turn bring your questions up to me so that I can in turn ask those questions following the prepared questions that I have gone through. At the conclusion, both of the debaters will be given 5 final minutes to wrap up with their final comments on the issues. So that's the format. I'm going to be giving signals to Professor Weaver, who in turn will be signaling the speakers when they have 30 seconds left with respect to all of these time sequences. And if they don't stop voluntarily within that 30 seconds, then I'm going to be saying it's time to stop. I have also informed both of them, and I want to inform all of you, they don't need to take their full amount of time at any given point. And any time that they cut will be more time for all of you to ask questions. With that as introduction to the ground rules, let me go ahead and let the debate begin. Joel?
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here today to speak about this very important issue. I got to admit, when I was asked if I would come here to Kansas State to talk about this important issue, I was thinking, well, what am I getting myself into? And then I read my byline that I'm a KU grad. You know, what am I going to the lion's den here? But then KU embarrassed itself with by losing for the second year in a row in the first round of the tournament. K-State won the women's NIT championship, so I thought, they're going to have pity on me. Great. So, well, I have been specializing in constitutional law for the last 6 to 7 years, most of them in Orlando, Florida. You might ask, why did I come up here then? And I do not know. But while we were in Orlando, Florida, my wife was shopping at Walmart with my son, who was 3 at the time. And my son told my wife, that guy over there is an evil man. And she thought, why would you say that man is an evil man? She goes, that guy getting out of the car is an evil man. And she goes, well, why would you say that? Well, then my wife noticed that on the front of the license plate was a wildcat. We were in Orlando, Florida. I guess it's nice to know that some things get passed down from generation to generation. If there's one thing, though, that I want you to leave with here tonight, it's this. Kids matter. Children matter. It cannot overstate the point to say that the existence of society depends on children and procreation. And marriage throughout history has served not for the purpose of creating a package of benefits. Marriage has not existed so that a person can marry their soulmate, as unromantic as that sounds, and I hope my wife doesn't get a copy of this transcript here. But marriage has not existed for those purposes throughout time. Marriage has existed for this one reason, and that is to manage procreation. Now, you're going to get an extra bang for your buck tonight because I'm going to give you a little sex education, Sex Education 101. Now, I have never taught a class on sex education, but I've been married for 15 years, and I have 2 kids, so I think I am qualified to speak on this topic a little bit. And that is this. When men are attracted to women, babies happen. Did you catch that? That is a phenomenon that has occurred throughout history. When men are attracted to women, babies happen. And the reason why this relationship between men and women, this marriage relationship, has been singled out for legal protection is that it is the only human relationship that can, one, produce the next generation of babies, and two, connect those babies with their biological mother and biological father. Now, these are results that are agreed upon by experts from both sides. Jonathan Raich, who is one of the well-known advocates for same-sex marriage, even he says the ideal, optimum result is that children be connected to and be raised by their biological mother and their biological father. And tonight, I was asked to comment on the legal issues regarding marriage. And the most important legal issue from coast to coast right now that's being litigated in the courts is this very issue. Who gets to decide? Marriage has been the most important, it's been the cornerstone block, the building block for all of society, for generations upon generations. And who gets to decide the issue of what is marriage? And who gets to participate in marriage? Who gets to decide that extremely important issue? And I maintain that it is not the right of judges who might have an agenda on one side or the other. I don't think a conservative right-wing judge should decide the issue. I don't think a left-wing judge should decide the issue. I think the people deserve to decide this issue on same-sex marriage. And with that, that is the most pressing legal issue facing America today regarding same-sex marriage.
Pedro?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am honored to be here with you today to see so many young people interested in this issue of civil rights. I had the pleasure of knowing Dorothy. She was a loving, caring, intelligent human being. Dorothy would be pleased to know that in her name, Kansas State University has established a lecture series with an emphasis on civil rights. Moreover, she would be most pleased to know that as a direct result of this lecture series, the cause of equality advanced. I am here today to proclaim that same-sex marriage is of benefit to society. I am here today to proclaim that same-sex marriage promotes family values. I am here today to proclaim that same-sex marriage is of benefit to children. I am here today to proclaim that same-sex marriage is beneficial to education. I am here today to proclaim that same-sex marriage is in our best national interest. I am here today to proclaim that our homosexual and transgender family, our brothers, our sisters, mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, cousins, do not any longer stand alone in their battle for justice. I am here to proclaim that there is a growing number of heterosexual men and women who are offended by the immoral, unfair, unjust, and unequal treatment, which is representative of the status quo. I am here to proclaim that together we will succeed in our efforts to bring about equality for our lesbian, gay, and transgender population. We must not be indifferent to human suffering. We must not be indifferent to injustice. We must not be indifferent to unequal treatment. As Mr. Eli Weissel, the Nobel Prize author of the book Night, stated so eloquently for us, indifference does not benefit the abused. It benefits the abuser. Same-sex marriage does not threaten heterosexual marriage. It does not. Same-sex marriage promotes family values. We will not allow extremists to deny the truth about same-sex marriage for their own political agenda. Same-sex marriage is opposed by some because they see it as sin. I defend their right to have faith of their choice. Religion is free in America. Mr. Oster, you and your supporters apparently have forgotten that we in America are also free from religion. Our public officials swear on the Bible to uphold the Constitution. They do not swear on the Constitution to uphold the Bible. The fact, Mr. Oster, that you view homosexuality as a sin is neither moral or legal justification for our government to treat homosexuals differently simply because of their sexual orientation. Marriage is simply a contract between consenting adults and a government. The government has an interest in maintaining marriage, in managing it. Children's care, custody, adoption, death benefits, taxes, and over 1,000 other issues are legitimate concerns of government with marriage. Regulation is therefore directly related to governmental interest. Since homosexuality is not a crime, since same-sex marriage has been proven by peer-reviewed studies to be of no harm, but in fact of benefit to the children of such marriages, the state has no legitimate interest in the denial of equal right to marry by same-sex partners. In fact, to deny them the right is to deny them without justification. Many of our country's men and women, including homosexuals, have paid the ultimate price to protect these rights. You should take a look at the American Psychiatric Association, the American Psychological Association, the Social Workers National Organizations, and many other well-recognized national scientific organizations. And they tell us that children of same-sex marriage do as well as children of heterosexual marriages. What is truly important, ladies and gentlemen, to the child is to be surrounded by love, understanding, and caring. Single homosexual parents do as well as heterosexual parents with their children. And finally, the myth, Mr. Oster, that you and others like you promote, that homosexual household children are more likely to be homosexual, is false. You, Mr. Oster, are unable to cite to any peer review studies showing any difference. Yet, with willful ignorance, you and others make hurtful and malicious comments without regard for the truth or the injury those comments cause to innocent children and their families. You, Mr. Oster, promote with your word anguish where none should be. You, Mr. Oster, with your words promote bullying of young homosexual children by making them out to be sinners, less equal and less deserving. I'm told I have 30 seconds. I could go on for 30 years. The bottom line is this. We need to remove the stain in our Constitution because we're denying a group of citizens the equal protection under the law for no other reason than their sexual orientation. It is abusive, it is inappropriate, and someday we will look back at our actions and ask ourselves, how did we do that?
Time. My first question I'm going to address first to Mr. Irigonegaray. It does have to do with an issue which I think may separate the two. My goal in asking all of these questions is for us to attempt as clearly as we can to identify the real differences in the positions that we see represented here this evening. Pedro, what is your understanding of sexual orientation, and in particular, is homosexuality inherent, or is it a matter of choice?
The best answer to that question was provided to me by the woman I love, Janet. Upon hearing the question, she said to me, you know what's important about that? In America, choice is sacred. We demand the right to choose. That's what freedom is all about. So whether homosexuality is a matter of choice, a matter of genetics, a matter of whatever, it doesn't matter. Just like it doesn't matter if you choose to be a Catholic or a Protestant, Jew, religion is choice. Mr. Brownback chose to be Catholic. How would he like if that choice cost him the right to marriage? How would he like it if that choice cost him ridicule? Quite the contrary, we protect that choice. My personal opinion is that sexual orientation is something that we're born with. I didn't choose one day to make a choice between Charlie or Charlene. It was always Charlene. But I know this, that doesn't give me a right to put a target on someone because they chose Charlie instead. And that's the danger we face here. History has shown us what happened when we single out people for differential treatment. The Nazis did it. It wasn't just the Jews they were after. Look at what they did to the homosexual population. We cannot allow history to repeat ourselves, and sadly, in America today, we are on our road to a theocracy, and it's people like Mr. Oster that will be telling us what we can and cannot do, and that's not a democracy that I want to live in. We need to stand up and say enough. We are based on a democracy where the equality of every citizen is judged to be equal. Enough is enough.
Joel?
Yeah, I'm actually surprised to hear that Mr. Irigonegaray is opposed to personal attacks. It seems like you're quite fond of personal attacks. But in any event, the question here is about choice. whether or not people are born with a choice. And I actually agree with my esteemed colleague here. That's an irrelevant question. It does not matter whether a person is born with a proclivity to homosexual tendencies or whether or not that's something that happens after they are put into a social environment. What legal consequence is that? Here's what the law states. Under the Equal Protection Clause of the United States Constitution, people must be treated equally and they cannot be denied fundamental rights. Well, what is a fundamental right? What the other side will argue is we have this fundamental right to marry. Well, really, what is marriage? What is marriage? Marriage is the union between one man and one woman. It's defined quantitatively and it's defined qualitatively between one man and one woman. What people on the opposing side would like to say here is that we want to change then the definition of marriage. And that's really what they're asking for here, is to change the definition of marriage and not get access to what we have now. I'll make this statement right here. Every single homosexual or lesbian can marry. That is true. What they're asking to do is to change the definition. As I explained in my opening remarks, marriage has historically always been to manage relationships that lead to procreation. They want to make sure that every baby that is born has more likely to manage the procreation. That is the purpose for marriage. What they're asking for here is that, no, we don't want, we want benefits and rights and packages. Well, what rights and benefits are they being denied? I spoke in Orlando, Florida, convention, actually before the Orlando City Council, over the issue of anti-discrimination provision. And during this, the issue was, can Orlando businesses discriminate against people because they are their homosexual status, homosexual behavior? And lo and behold, all these people came forward with all of these testimonies and all of these examples of how they were discriminated against. But here's how every story started. I know somebody, my friend, my brother. There were no personal stories of discrimination. And then got me thinking, you know, I've been alive for quite a few years on this earth. Have I ever seen anybody discriminated against? Where is this widespread discrimination that they claim to exist? They're not asking for the alleviation of discrimination. It is not a significant problem like race was a significant problem that was dealt with appropriately by the people changing their constitution and not courts. So whether or not homosexuality is you're born with it or whether or not it's something that happens by the social interaction that you have is an irrelevant question as far as the law is concerned.
1 minute.
That's absolutely ridiculous. That's all.
Okay.
In the interest of the well-intentioned and polite and courteous debate that Dorothy Thompson exemplified, could we dampen the enthusiasm here? I think that we need to listen to both sides and later on in the evening, for example, in the reception that follows afterwards, there'll be plenty of time to make our personal opinions known. So on behalf of the Dorothy Thompson Lecture Series, I am asking you to please be even-handed in your responses here. And if that means no response, then please just listen and respond later. Thank you.
Joel, can you explain as specifically as possible the harm that you would experience from allowing same-sex partners to marry?
When I was in San Francisco, California, on the Gavin Newsome case, that specific question was asked to me by a reporter covering the case after we got done with our arguments. And it really got me thinking about the harm and what is the harm. And here's what I have concluded. First of all, we are attorneys here. And to pretend that we are experts in sociology would be to selling you a bill of goods. We are attorneys. Now, I can make a couple observations about harm. These are my couple observations that I've made. Number one, there is a significant thing of the cumulative effect of harm. You know, this same argument of, well, how does my marriage impact your marriage was also made a couple generations ago when no-fault divorce was being debated and argued. The argument was this. Well, how would no-fault divorce for my marriage impact your marriage? We're an island unto ourselves. And what happens between me and my wife has no impact on your marriage. Two generations later, the impact of no-fault divorce has been significant, if not almost dealing a tremendous death blow to marriage, if not the one of the single most causes of the downfall of marriage today is no-fault divorces. It's obvious that when you deal with marriage law, you adjust marriage law, it does have an impact on all of marriage. It reminds me of a story I heard about a tobacco lawyer who went to Little Johnny and gave him a cigarette. And after Little Johnny took one puff of the cigarette, he then proclaimed, oh, look, there's no harm in smoking cigarettes because there's no harm to Little Johnny. It ignores the cumulative effect. And I also make this other observation. The Loving v. Smith case is a Supreme Court case that dealt with whether or not interracial marriage. And there was a statute that prohibited interracial marriage. Of course, it was a horrible statute. It was in violation of the 14th Amendment of the Constitution. Clearly, it was an unconstitutional law. But the Supreme Court struck down that statute that prohibited interracial marriage. 15 years later, you have a situation where you would lose your tax-exempt status if you even suggested that interracial marriage was a bad thing. So we went from 15 years from banning a statute that prohibited interracial marriage to banning the speech on interracial marriage. If that same thing happens to here, what we're going to have is in regards to traditional marriage, with the optimal situation where kids can be brought up with their mother and their father, it will impact our speech in 15 years from now. That is the slippery slope of the law, and that's what we are dealt with.
My understanding of the law in the domestic arena has been enlightened by one of the most intelligent human beings I know. Her name is Linda Elrod, Professor Cricket Elrod, as her students know her. She is the chairperson of the bar, the American Bar Association section on domestic law. And I had this discussion about no-fault divorce with Cricket because the radicals, the extremists, those who are telling us what God wants in our laws want domestic issues to be resolved with fault. And let me tell you what that means. That means if two people determine that they no longer want to live with each other because of their own private personal reasons, that to protect their children, they can go to a judge and say, look, we simply disagree. We don't want to stay together. We wish to divorce. And as friends, they can walk away, taking first concern with their children. But no, what they want is for a parent, in order to get divorced, to come in and show fault with the other parent. It doesn't have to be that way, Mr. Oster. And we hope those days don't return. They are harmful to children. And the suggestion you make that the case of Loving versus Virginia, a pivotal case in civil rights in the United States, wherein in 1967, the United States of America finally said through its Supreme Court, you cannot deny the right of a black person to marry a white woman, because in those days they could be imprisoned. For you to say that the evilness of that decision is that 15 years later one could not criticize the wrongfulness of denying black and whites to marry is reason to support the marriage amendment, because if you do not support the marriage amendment, what, 15 years down the road, we're going to deny you the right to say that this was bad? That's nonsense. It is nonsense. Those issues have nothing to do with one another. Nothing. There is no harm that comes from allowing same-sex marriage. All the research proves the opposite. They will bring out from time to time psychologists that are not longer licensed by the American Psychological Association to support their extremist views. If you want to know whether or not there's harm, I urge you, study. Don't rely on those that tell you they know what God thinks.
Time.
Research it, learn it, be smart about it.
Loving v. Virginia is a great case for civil rights, and I never insinuated that it wasn't. And here's why it was a good case. It was the correct application of the law, because the people stood up and they ratified their constitution and they outlawed slavery, and the Loving v. Virginia decision was based on the people standing up and being heard. And that is not what we have going on in America today. We have judges, we have an agenda of people with an agenda going to the courts and saying, we want you to give us same-sex marriage. But because we can't get it on ourselves, and because the people are opposed to same-sex marriage. And that is not the proper way in which a democracy is run. Secondly, I want to just take a quick opportunity here to comment about no-fault divorce. It's not really the issue we have before us here. But it is an example of how people looking to themselves and only to themselves will make a decision and ignore the impact that decision will have on their children. Children are being left behind as if they are just mere inconvenience and are not being put in the forefront of our society. And kids matter. Children matter. And we need to start looking towards the next generation of kids and preparing them and making them a priority in our communities.
Time. Thank you. Okay. Pedro, when addressing constitutional issues pertaining to same-sex marriage, what weight should be given to our history, our traditions, and our religious heritage?
Our history, our traditions, our religious heritage. Well, perhaps we need to consider which of those. And once we decide which, what parts? Do we look at our history where we came to the United States and murdered millions of Native Americans so we could steal their land? Do we look at our traditions, enslaving African Americans and denying them in our original Constitution the dignity of being considered a human being? Do we look at our religious views historically that denied women the right to vote? What do we look at when we look at those histories? I suggest to you that we should look at the history that makes us free. Our traditions of freedom, of justice, of equality for all. I urge churches across the country to exercise whatever faith they wish to practice. It is part of being an American. I come from a country where those rights were taken away. And they were not taken away because those in government were smarter. They were taken away from us because we, the Cuban people, failed in our responsibility to our government, to our nation. And we've paid a heavy price. We cannot fail here. We are the beacon of democracy, of freedom. We should encourage freedom at every turn. We should oppose hate at every turn. Our traditions, our heritage, our culture all suggest that we grow, we learn from our mistakes. In learning from our mistakes, we should recognize the fact that what we have been doing with our homosexual population and our transgender population is not in the best interest of our nation. They are our family, and we should stop referring to them as they and consider them as us.
I hate to disappoint you, but I absolutely agree. We need to learn from our history, from the good part of our history and from the bad part of our history, to make sure that we do not repeat the bad part of our history, and to make sure that as much as possible we repeat or improve on the good part of our history. And I can't agree with you more on that. Now let me explain to you a little bit about how that history works into the law. Under the law, you have this thing called a right to privacy that the Supreme Court said was found in a number of our rights, and that related to contraception back in the mid-1960s. And they call this right to privacy a fundamental right. And in fact, recently, I'm sure you've heard of the case called Lawrence v. Texas, which involved two homosexuals doing some in the privacy of their own home, consensual sexual acts. And the Supreme Court said, of course, you have the right to engage in that privacy of your own home, that private conduct. But here is the key. It does not extend outside the home. Because when you go outside the home, it is no longer a right to privacy, but it's a public right. When you are talking about the right to same-sex marriage, it's not what people want to do in their home. See, that's the whole misconception. They have that right today. You have the right to privacy to do whatever you want to do in your house, as long as it doesn't impact a third party or a third person's rights. You have that right to do that. And that is not being denied anyone. What they are asking for here is the public right to be the public stamp of approval on a homosexual relationship. And that is not, and it is different from the right to privacy. Now, how do we determine what is a fundamental right? What you do is you go back and you look at this nation's history and traditions to find out what has been a fundamental right. Now, how do you add fundamental rights? How do you change fundamental rights? You do that by amending the Constitution, not by going piecemeal to piecemeal, through court to court, to try to find a judge who might happen to agree with you, and then declaring that a fundamental right. That is not how our system of democracy works. It works through the will of the people being spoken through, and that is, if you want to look no further than look to the issue of slavery to see how that worked out. And you had, slavery was a horrible practice that this nation was engaging in, and the people stood up and they spoke and they stopped it. And it's taken some time to eradicate all the negative effects from that. And I say that if that's what the people on the same-sex agenda want, then do that. Stand up. Go to the legislature and be heard. But do not go to the courts piecemeal by piecemeal, because that's not how our democratic process works.
You clearly have no understanding of how our democratic process works. How dare you say it is inappropriate to go to the courts? How dare you suggest that the legal system is an inappropriate remedy? How dare you ignore the separation of powers? How dare you call yourself a constitutional scholar and make those type of ludicrous statements? The courts are there for a purpose. The courts are there to protect us, to review constitutional issues, to suggest that one cannot go to the courts is not only wrong, it is propaganda. It is the type of propaganda that's raising millions of dollars for people like him, from innocent people like you who hear this about activist judges. Thank God for judges. They are out there protecting your constitutional rights. Beware of people that make those blanket statements about the judiciary.
Time. Joel, should there be any limits on discrimination based upon sexual orientation? And should there be any protection of privacy rights for those involved in same-sex relationships?
What was the second question, Mike? Statement was taken. Can you repeat the second question?
Sure. Should there be any limits on discrimination based upon sexual orientation, and should there be any protection of privacy rights for those involved in same-sex relationships?
Right. First of all, to comment on what Mr. Irigonegaray just said about the courts. The courts are there to protect your rights, and I absolutely agree with that statement, and you should go to the courts to have your rights protected. But I am opposed to going to the courts and having them create your rights. And that is not the function of the courts. That is the function of the legislature. And enough on that. Are there any limits to the discrimination? Again, it's a very much a loaded question. You know, this again, I don't want to disappoint you, but I'm not for discrimination. I don't think you should discriminate. I think that if a person who is homosexual wants to rent a house, they should rent a house to them. I'm a landlord. I have 10 residences. And I would not discriminate against somebody who wanted to rent a house for me. If I were driving a taxi cab and somebody said, I want to ride, but me and my lover, I'd let him in my taxi cab. If I were at a hotel and somebody came in and wanted to reserve a room, or at a restaurant, you get the idea. In fact, I've never been in a taxi cab, I have never been to a restaurant, never been to a hotel, and seen anybody be discriminated against. And if they were, I would stand up for them, because that's not right. But that's not what we're talking about here. And what we're talking about here is same-sex marriage. And when you're talking about them trying to get same-sex marriage, they're trying to create a special right. This is not, they're trying to change the definition of marriage between being between one man and one woman, and then being between two people of the same sex. That is changing the definition of marriage. It's like saying, all right, could you please draw for me a square circle? You can't draw a square circle. It's not possible. Marriage is what it is. If people who are homosexual behavior, they exhibit homosexual behavior, if they feel like they're being denied certain rights, and they need to seek redress for that. But let's talk about some of the rights that they're being denied. A right to leave your property to your loved one. They have that right. It's called a will. A right to go to a hospital. They have that right. And if they're being denied that right, they need to seek redress and go to the hospital and change that. But they have a right to go see their loved one in a hospital. It's called a medical directive. The right to employment. They can get a job. I don't see any problem. I do not oppose, or I do not support discrimination against people who exhibit homosexual behavior. The right to privacy, again, this is another red herring that we have before us today. This is not a right to privacy that we're talking about. That was decided in Lawrence. What we're talking about is a public right, not a right to engage in conduct in your own home. And with that, I yield the floor.
Pedro.
Of what benefit would your right of free speech would be to you if you could only speak inside your home? Of what benefit would it be to you to be treated equally in the privacy of your home, but not in the public sector? That is absolutely without merit. The private versus public argument is unmeritorious. It doesn't make sense. You have no right to deny public expression of love between homosexual people, just like you have no right to deny public expression of hope, of love, by heterosexual people. And if we are to take you at your word and believe that you would give a homosexual a ride, if we're to take you at your word that you would not discriminate in rent, if we're to take you at your word that you treat them all equally, then please tell me by what specific reason do you claim the authority to suggest that they should not be given the right to marry? Because if they are so ill adapted for that relationship, wouldn't it also apply to others that you already agree are perfectly acceptable? What is the differential? What is the logical differential? The threat to marriage? Procreation? I'll tell you this. I could be in an abandoned island with three men for 20 years. I will never find a sexual attraction. It's not there. I don't have a single friend that had children that has told me, gee, could I have married a man? Or if homosexuals could marry, I don't know if I would have married a woman. That is nonsense. We marry those that we fall in love with. This earlier notion about marriage being for procreation, history doesn't say that. And thank God in America that's not required. We don't marry for procreation. Many adults marry not have any children. Some choose not to when they're young. Procreation is a consequence of marriage. It's also a consequence of single sex adults. So procreation is not really the issue here.
Time.
With all due respect, your recollection of history is not accurate. The purpose for marriage throughout the time, throughout the thousands of years of the existence, has been to manage procreation. I'm not saying that everybody gets married to procreate. I'm not saying that should be a requirement. I'm saying that has been the purpose for providing special legal recognition and obligations and benefits to this thing called the marriage license, this marriage relationship. That is what, and so marriage has historically been between man and woman. That is what it is. You mentioned that, well, if you want to rent to somebody, if you want to offer them a ride in your taxi cab, then why can't they also marry? Again, because the purpose of marriage is to manage procreation. That is historically what it's been, and every child deserves to be raised by their mother and their father. And the only relationship, the only human relationship where that is possible, where you can guarantee that, is through a marriage relationship. Now, when you talk about, what good is it if you can only speak in your house? You can be a homosexual couple outside of your house. Since when is that against the law? You can be a homosexual couple inside your house, and you can be a homosexual couple outside your house. You're not confined to your own house. Again, that's not what this issue is about. This issue is... Thank you.
This is an appropriate time for me to let people know if you have questions and would like to put them on a card and bring them forward. There are a couple of people back in the corner ready to bring those questions forward. I've already received quite a number of them, but I would welcome additional questions. And I still have a couple more questions that I plan to ask. Let me start, go next to Pedro. Pedro, are there specific problems with the Kansas State Constitutional Amendment which limits marriage relationships?
Yes, Professor, I believe there are. First, I view the amendment presently in our Constitution as a stain on civil rights. I see it as an insult to justice and equality. The amendment, particularly Section 2, is vague and ambiguous. It is impossible to define. It attempts to exclude from all others, except men and women that are married, the rights and incidents of marriage. And what are those? The legislature could not define it. No one can define it. It is this vague and ambiguous term that was placed in the Constitution, in the amendment, in an effort to further limit freedom, to further limit equality. But sadly, it's gone too far, just like the Romer case out of Colorado, where a constitutional amendment passed whose only purpose was to deny in the future any municipality from providing additional benefits, not to a special group, not special rights. That's another propaganda word used by these individuals. We do not seek special rights for the homosexual. We do not seek special rights for the transgender population. We seek equality. They are being treated specially right now by being treated unequal. We want to stop the special treatment. And we want to provide equal treatment. So we're going to take that word from you and those like you and say, you're right. Homosexuals are being treated specially right now, specially poorly, specially unequal, and specially unjustifiably, they're being denied the right to marry. Our Constitution should be, and historically has always been, a beacon of freedom. It provides greater freedom. This is the first time that our Constitution has had an amendment to take freedom from a class of people, a class of human beings. Those of you in this audience that are homosexual, that are transgender, that have members in your family that are homosexual or transgender, speak out. Let others know what the nightmare of discrimination is like. We need to stop it. That's the problem with the amendment.
Time.
It denies freedom.
Obviously, I do not have any problem with the Kansas Amendment. Let me talk about a couple different legal issues regarding the Kansas Amendment. First of all, I want to thank you, Bill Rich, for an excellent debate that you engaged in last year, about a year ago, with my colleague Kevin Terrio, where you took the opposite position. We were advocating that the Kansas Amendment was unconstitutional. That was very enlightening. And since then, I believe one of your main points was that Part B was unconstitutional. A year later, we still have not seen any challenge to Part B. And here's why. Part B is not unconstitutional. Part B basically prohibits any other marriage-like relationship other than a man and a woman. That was a clear meaning, that was a clear intent, and there has been no legal challenges in the year since it was passed. Now, this idea that somehow the Kansas Amendment targets a certain class of people is also unfounded in the amendment. What the amendment does is it protects traditional marriage. That is its purpose. Its purpose is not to target an insidious group for special discrimination. It protects marriage. In other words, all other relationships shall not be afforded the protection of marriage. So if a man and a woman decide to live together and not be married, that will not be considered a marriage relationship. That's not a homosexual couple, that's a heterosexual couple. If a man decides to live with another man and another woman, that is not going to receive protection in Kansas as if it were a marriage. This is not attacking a certain group. This is protecting traditional marriage. And why should traditional marriage be protected? Because that is the best and only way to manage relationships, human relationships that allow for kids to be brought up by their mother and their father. Now, is that saying that everybody's going to be brought up by their mother and father? No, that's not the truth. Does that mean that if you were brought up in a home without your mother and father, that you're going to turn out to be bad? No, we all know that that's not the case. People overcome difficulties all the time. What we are saying is the optimum situation for a kid is to be brought up by their biological mother and biological father, and that is a point that is uncontested by experts on both sides of the issue. There is nothing wrong with the Kansas Constitution. It was designed to promote marriage and to benefit kids, and there has not been a legal challenge in the year since. Thank you.
1 minute.
Don't give up faith. Look, their argument boils down, as far as marriage, to one issue. They want to manage your marriage. They want to manage you. They want to control you. We are saying, no, you don't. You don't have a right to do that. You don't have a right to impose your views on us, our brothers, our sisters, our mothers, our fathers. Would your people, in their strong belief for marriage and procreation, deny divorce? I bet not, because you can't be that hypocritical. Because so many of those that stand with you do divorce. So let's be realistic. Let's stop being hypocritical. And let's recognize that the best management of domestic affairs is a system which does not discriminate, in reality cares for children and their welfare.
Time. I'm going to, at this stage, depart from the final question I was going to ask, because I've received so many questions from all of you. I'm also going to change the format just slightly to go to asking you to limit your comments to just 2 minutes for each, and I'll go just to each of you once rather than having the three-part series. This again, just to be sure that we get a number of these questions in before the time that we need to begin our wrap-up. Okay. Joel, I think this goes first to you. My question is this. How is taking away the rights of minority gays and then of a minority gays and then argue the point that it is constitutional? It seems that this is more of an issue of majority getting its way more than any rational or constitutional issue.
Now, there has never been a constitutional right to same-sex marriage. And so you are not denying them a constitutional right. That has never existed. No court has ever found there's a constitutional right to marriage. That is, there is some litigation going on now, and that issue is going to be decided by an appellate court or by the Supreme Court of the United States. So you are not denying a constitutional right to somebody, because the constitutional right does not exist. You might ask, well, what about the right to privacy? Again, you have the right to privacy. A homosexual couple has the right to be a couple, to live in our society. That is not a right that's being denied them. When you're talking about the right to marriage, you're talking about changing marriage. And the homosexuals have a right to marriage, because marriage is the union of one man and one woman. There is no homosexual that will go and try to get a marriage license and will be denied, because the marriage license is between one man and one woman. What they want to do is change the law of marriage. But again, this does not deal with the right to privacy, because they already have that right to privacy. Thank you.
Please do me a favor. Vote. This is a political issue. Get involved in your local politics. America is headed down a very dangerous path. People like Mr. Oster are gaining great power. We need to challenge it. Please get involved. The Kansas Equality Coalition, contact your local chapter. Make sure that you get involved. Kansas Equality Coalition, check it out on the website. We need to elect people who are respectful of all our citizens. We need to elect people that care about the equality of all our citizens. We need to elect people that will provide children with the dignity they deserve, regardless of their sexual orientation. We need to stop abuse. We need to laugh a little more. We need to take care of each other. There's over 50,000 children going to bed hungry tonight in Kansas. There are millions of children across the country without health insurance. We're in a horrible war where thousands of people are dying every day. And our government is talking to us about religion. It's a distraction. It's an insult. Let's get back to what matters, and that's governing America with good constitutional basis, with intelligent policymakers. Let's go out and elect public officials that will do that for us. Let's put an end to the insanity that we are facing today. If we don't get involved, nobody's going to do it for you. Please become politically involved.
Let me also comment on a difficulty I am having. I have before me at least 20 questions, and I think at least 19 of them are addressed to Mr. Oster. If any of you have some questions that you would like for me to direct specifically to Mr. Irigonegaray, I would welcome them. And what I'm going to do is next ask a question again of Mr. Oster and go somewhat out of sequence, but I think it will work best if we do it that way. A number of people have asked a question very similar to this one. Joel, is it your position that Brown versus Board of Education should have waited for the American people to get a constitutional amendment to rid us of separate but equal schools?
Well, they didn't have to wait. There was an amendment that was passed in the 1860s called the 14th Amendment that outlawed slavery and all incidents of slavery. Absolutely, they don't have to wait. In fact, it was long overdue. People stood up, they voted, they changed their constitution, they saw a harm, and they changed and they fixed that harm. And I would encourage you the same, as Mr. Irigonegaray just did, that if you see harm out there, if you see people being discriminated against, and you do stand up, and you do be, and I want your voice to be heard. And I absolutely agree with that. Brown v. The case Brown v. Board of Education was about whether or not separate but equal facilities are appropriate. That was the Supreme Court fixing its own problem that it created in Plessy v. Ferguson back in the late 1800s. That was an unconstitutional opinion back in the late 1800s, and they were fixing their own problem. But they didn't have to wait for a constitutional amendment. There was a constitutional amendment.
Pedro?
I just feel very fortunate to live in a country where the Supreme Court ruled as it did in Brown versus Board of Education in 1954. A country that in 1964 passed the Civil Rights Act. A country that in 1967 passed the Loving versus Virginia case. Country that recently had the Lawrence case out of Texas. The Supreme Court is important. That's why the appointments to the Supreme Court are so important. That's why we should keep the political process out of the Supreme Court and pay particular attention in Kansas, because the radicals, the extremists, want to change our Supreme Court by allowing the Senate to tell the governor whether or not what has worked for years, whether or not her appointments are going to be approved. Let's keep politics out of our courts as much as possible. Is it fair to say that courts are apolitical? Well, no. It's impossible to remove one's political views as a judge. But historically, they've done their best. They not always get it right. Mr. Oster is right, in particularly as it related to our civil rights issues. The courts have often gotten it wrong. But that doesn't mean we can't go to them, and that doesn't mean that we shouldn't. In fact, we should require the third branch of government to be of help to us whenever any of you feel that you're being mistreated. That's what our courts are for. We need good judges. Please vote, get involved. We need you.
Okay. This is a question for Pedro. In Loving versus Virginia, marriage was found to be a fundamental right in theory. If the issue is ever addressed by the Supreme Court, is the court required to use strict scrutiny standards of review, meaning the law in question must be justified by compelling governmental interest and by the least restrictive means possible?
There's a variety of ways in which the court could look at it, but I can't imagine there being a challenge to that case. What is the purpose to go back and suggest that it is in fact criminal conduct? I don't think that's going to happen. Bill, would you repeat the last part of that question for me, please?
In theory, if the issue is ever addressed by the Supreme Court, is the court required to use strict scrutiny standard of review, meaning the law in question must be justified by a compelling governmental interest and by the least restrictive means possible?
As we said earlier, I think privacy would be an issue, whether or not there is any type of a compelling interest by the court, shown to the court for the state to make a denial of those rights, and I just don't believe that would ever occur. I think that decision is sound and safe.
Yeah, the strict scrutiny would be applied in a challenge to marriage. However, there is no right to same-sex marriage, and no court has ever held that. In fact, in Lawrence v. Texas, the court made sure to mention they were not ruling on same-sex marriage. There is no fundamental right to same-sex marriage. It would not receive strict scrutiny review. It would receive rational basis review, as it received in Romer and as it was analyzed in some people argue, but in the Lawrence case, there's some dispute as to that. But the general consensus was rational basis was applied, and it failed rational basis. But even so, that was a privacy issue, not an issue of same-sex marriage. And so I believe that if same-sex marriage were to be litigated before the Supreme Court, you would not see strict scrutiny applied. You would see rational basis. Conversely, if you see marriage ever litigated before the Supreme Court, it would receive strict scrutiny review. Thank you.
Okay. Joel, there are a number of questions that are variants of this one. The question, the statement is, my sister and her husband are raising three adopted children from mainland China here in their home in America. These children would otherwise have been raised in poverty. Would they have been better off with their biological parents?
You know, who knows? I don't know the facts of that case. This is a personal issue to me. My wife is adopted, and I often wonder what were the facts behind that, but I don't know. But you never let exceptions make the law. And the general rule is that kids are better off when they're raised by their mother and the father. When you're crafting public policy, your public policy should be thus, and that promotes a system in marriage that allows for the children to be raised by their mother and their father. Of course, there's going to be adoption. Of course, there's going to be situations where kids need to get out of an abusive environment. Nobody is saying that kids should remain in an environment that is abusive. Absolutely not. So obviously you can't answer that question without knowing the specific facts of that situation. Obviously there are times when kids should be taken out of a home if their physical safety is being threatened. But experts on both sides agree with this point, and that is, as a general rule, kids deserve to be raised by their mother and their father, and they are better off when they are raised by both their biological mother and their biological father. I remember Mr. Irigonegaray mentioned earlier some test that said there has never been proven that kids raised by a homosexual parent fared just as well as kids raised by a heterosexual parent. Well, that study actually only compared the homosexual child with the child raised by a single heterosexual female, not a traditional family. And so that study has been disreputed. Thank you.
That's absolutely false. Read the literature on your own and you'll see what I'm talking about. But look,
Pedro, I think we are going just...
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought he got the question, and it was my turn to respond.
Did I start that with you?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Pedro, your turn to respond.
That doesn't happen often that Bill is wrong. Look, who didn't want to have Wally Cleaver's mom and dad? I did. My dad couldn't speak English. I wanted Wally's dad, who could speak English. We all would like the perfect mom and dad scenario. But you know, those perfect moms and dad sometimes have homosexual children. Homosexual children that they love. And they wish for those homosexual children the same rights and benefits of their heterosexual children. So don't give me this garbage about the perfect family. Let's instead concentrate on what is the environment in which that child is in. Because there are times that a mother and a father may be the worst thing for the child. That's not the issue. Children are resilient so long as they're nurtured, they're provided love, attention, education, hope, equality, justice, food, medical care. That's what we ought to be worried about. That's what the political discussion should be. My God, if I were to bring to you and read Sam Brownback's interview with the Rolling Stone, you would see how closely they match. That's our political reality today in Kansas. What is the matter with Kansas? We're losing touch with values. We are allowing a few to take values from us. There is no value in putting a target on the homosexual. There is no value in denying people equality. There is no value in a legislature that still to this day doesn't have an educational budget for our children. There is no value in a state that denies the existence of evolution. There is no right in a state that is trying to take from women the right to choose. That's their agenda. We stand for freedom. We stand for justice.
Time.
And so should you.
Okay, I have questions now for Pedro. And Pedro, this first one, which I have a couple of variants on, are you only suggesting civil rights for bisexual, lesbian, gay, and transsexual individuals? Why not also for marriages with three people or more, or young kids or animals?
I will not dignify that question with my response.
Well, let me throw it back at you because I don't like the last part of that question, but go ahead and address the polygamy question.
I am not here advocating polygamy. There are many issues with polygamy that are really problematic, and the experts that understand family tensions and disputes can talk about that. I'm not an expert in the area, and unlike others, I choose to try to limit my expressions, particularly in a forum like this, to issues that I'm familiar with. The issue here is whether or not same-sex marriage should be allowed. And the answer, I hope, you all will clearly walk away from here believing is yes.
And the reason why he does not want to answer that question straightforwardly is because he can't. When you deal with same-sex marriage, you make all the arguments of why people should be able to marry whomever they want, whomever they love, whatever kind of relationship we want to enter into, that same rationale also applies to polygamy. It is a legal fact, a legal argument that they just simply don't want to admit. But the ACLU has responded to that, and the ACLU does defend polygamy's right to marry. That is already happening. I don't want to hear an argument about a slippery slope because we're already there. There is no more slippery slope. They're already arguing in court the right to polygamous marriages. And that is a logical follow-up from their argument of why they should be allowed to have same-sex marriage. What is the argument for same-sex marriage? Well, if I may make your argument for you, that's who they love. That's who they want to be with. You should not deny this right to a person who is homosexual because that is their soulmate. And you shouldn't deny this right to them. Well, what about the person who is both heterosexual and homosexual? They like both. What about that person? How come he can't also marry and have the state recognize and bless his relationship? It is doublespeak for him to say he supports one and not the other because you can't. The legal arguments apply to both. And that, unfortunately, our culture is going there pretty fastly. I don't have to advertise a show that's being run on cable now where they are glorifying a polygamous relationship. Our society will get there. And the question is, why should we not allow for polygamous relationships? Is it because of religious beliefs of some people who oppose it? Is it because of we want to instill our moral values on others? No, it's because it's bad for society and it's bad for children. And the same argument applies to protect marriage where a kid deserves to have be raised by his mother and his father. Now, again, we're not talking about, I'm sorry, I'm out of time, I'll finish later.
Okay. Joel, I have a couple of variations of this question, and in fact, I'm going to put a couple of them together. The question starts, why can't we change the definition of marriage? Isn't the hidden reason for not allowing same-sex marriage economics? If we allow it, that means insurance companies, the IRS, and other companies would have to dish out more money. And related to it, isn't insurance and the IRS and so forth an example of discrimination against same-sex couples?
I have not heard of those arguments being raised in support of same-sex marriage. And I definitely take issue with that last statement that they're being discriminated against by the IRS. It's quite the opposite. And if you're filing your taxes here in a couple weeks, you know exactly what I speak. There's a marriage penalty for as far as the IRS is concerned. And so I don't think the IRS is discriminating against them. They're discriminating against married people. In any event, I lost now what the question was.
So have I. Isn't the hidden reason for not allowing same-sex marriage economics? If we allow it, that means insurance companies, the IRS, and other companies would have to dish out more money.
Yeah, no, I don't believe it's economics. Maybe somebody can shed some light on that for me. I believe the main issue of why people are opposing same-sex marriage is because they want to protect traditional marriage as the cornerstone of society in which you raise children, and it creates the optimum environment for raising children.
Commissioner?
I respectfully disagree. I don't believe that the economic issue is really in the forefront of this effort. I think that this is bigotry. We've got to call it what it is. This is bigotry. This is an issue of civil rights. This is an issue that someday we will look back and say, shame on us. That's what this is about. And there are many damages that flow to those that are being denied equality under the law in marriage. There's over 1,000 federal and state protections that they do not have access to without any basis in law. The only reason you have heard time and time again for that denial is Mr. Oster's and the Alliance Defense Fund. Take a look at their website. They're out there fighting for Jesus. I don't remember being taught about a militant Jesus. I don't remember being taught about a Jesus that was so angry that he was filled with hate. I remember being taught about a Jesus that was inclusive, a Jesus that went to the prostitute, a Jesus who said, give to Caesar what Caesar. Marriage is about two adults consenting in a relationship with the state. If in addition to that, those same individuals wish to have a religious service, I will defend their right to do so. That's the beauty of America. And that's the beauty they're trying to rub away. Don't let them.
Time. And just as a note, I don't need any more questions. Pedro, this one is for you to start with. What do you believe throughout history has been the purpose of marriage?
Well, we know that in ancient Greece, men exchanged rings. We know that the Catholic Church did not become involved in marriage until the Middle Ages. We know that in England, it was a civil ceremony. So the history of marriage and its purpose is broad in scope, depending upon the society, the time, the needs, because as human beings, we're changing. What I do hope, Mr. Oster, that you leave here with, perhaps it's with an understanding that love is important. Caring for one another is important. The joy of sitting with a partner and sharing a conversation. The joy of looking at a painting with someone you love and saying, what do you think? Or walking out of a movie. Or the joy of having a pet that you both love. Or taking a walk in the park. Based upon the history of humanity, I would suggest to you that that ought to be the purpose of marriage. That ought to be companionship, caring. It's not only about sex. It's not. It simply is not true. And it's not about simply sex for our homosexual family. It's about the same desires, the same dreams, the same aspirations, the same hopes that you and your wife probably share, Mr. Oster, or that at least I hope you share. That's what marriage, to me, should be. And when it comes time, because the two of you no longer agree, to be able to do so with as little as possible animus between the parties,
time.
Without the need for hate.
I heard mentioned that love is important. I absolutely agree. That sitting with one spouse and talking is important. Sitting is important. Walking out of a movie, that's important. Walking in a park, those are all important things. and none of those are being denied to people with a homosexual behavior. That is not what this is about. Again, I ask you, I implore you, if you see that happening, if you see a homosexual who's being denied the right to walk out of a movie theater, I want you to call your legislator right then, put it on your speed dial, and call him. That will not be tolerated and should not be tolerated, and that's not happening. What we have in marriage, I really do respect your opinion, but it's not right. Historically, marriage has been about one thing, and that is managing procreation. The marriage relationship between husband and wife is the only relationship where you can make sure and you govern the production of children for the next generation, where a child is brought up by their mother and their father. And that has been the historical purpose of marriage throughout time. Have there been different constructs of marriage in a given society? Sure, I guess there have been. I'm not going to debate about that. But the predominant form of marriage throughout society, the purpose of marriage has been one thing: to manage procreation. If you want all these other rights, I would maintain you're not being denied them. And if a person is a homosexual, exhibit homosexual behavior, I implore them to walk out of the movie theater and see what happens. Thank you.
Okay. Building on the comments you just made and questions that were triggered by earlier comments as well, a number of people asked questions related to this one. Polygamy is the historical definition of marriage, starting with concubines in Egypt. Marriage between two people is a new historical phenomenon. Why should we uphold a new and religious-based definition?
Actually, polygamy has been a historical model of marriage, and that was in regards to managing procreation. You do have a problem with polygamy, as Jonathan Rauch has pointed out, and that is if one man is allowed to marry five wives, and that means four of the men can't marry. And so you created the situation where you had all these men who weren't being able to marry because there weren't the women to marry. And we can debate about the problems of polygamy. You know, I think that we pretty much would agree that it's not good for society. But in any event, those civilizations aside that did practice polygamy in the recent past, in American history, to be sure, and even going beyond that, it has been between a man and a woman in regards to producing children. Even in a polygamous relationship, you're going to have children being produced. That is possible. And so it would still serve that purpose of managing procreation. That's all I have.
Would you repeat the question, sir?
Polygamy is the historical definition of marriage, starting with concubines in Egypt. Marriage between two people is a new historical phenomena. Why should we uphold a new and religious-based definition?
We shouldn't. It's got nothing to do with religion. Marriage, the contract of marriage, is between two consenting adults and a state. I keep hearing about our history and our traditions. Let's resolve tonight that if we're going to use history, tradition, as a model from which to draw guidance for our present conduct, that we will draw on that history, we will draw on those traditions that enhance our freedoms, and disattach ourselves from those that we know historically cost us harm. For there is no benefit in attachment when that attachment is harmful, when that attachment has been shown to be inappropriate for the welfare of society. So, yes, let's consider history in the light of how we have learned from it, so that we will better know where to go.
Okay, this is the last question that I'm going to ask before we have the wrap-up from both of you, and it seemed like a reasonable one to end on. And Pedro, we'll start with you. How do both of you propose facilitating civil dialogue on this issue?
Thank you.
First, I suggest to you that what makes a difference in our country is our ability to do what we are doing here today. For as much as I disagree with Mr. Oster, when this is over, I will go over and shake his hand. And I wish him no ill. I wish him no harm. Quite the contrary. I wish him joy. I wish him health. So the civil discourse should be one in which the truth is brought out, where we listen without bias, where we become informed, where we study, where we learn what the facts are, so that we may have a more learned opinion. For an opinion based on ignorance is of little value, both to the speaker and to the listener. So question your public servants. Write letters. Do you really feel comfortable with government telling you that marriage is so that they can control, manage procreation of your children and your children's grandchildren? What is the next rule that they'll come up with? Who's next? What if you don't fit with the Jesus faith? What if I'm a Muslim?
Time.
It's getting scarier and scarier that I'm finding more points to which I agree with you. Absolutely. We need civil discourse, less name calling. We need to look at all the facts and put forth all of the evidence and consider it carefully. And we need to contact our elected representatives and let them know exactly how we feel on these issues. I agree wholeheartedly. I will make a couple of points on this. First of all, the first point I want to make is we need to stop thinking of ourselves only and think of other people. We need to be outward thinking about other people, and that's our kids. We need to set the kids as our standard and not experiment with them in some part of social experiment, because the kids do not deserve that, nor are they fodder for experimentation. Secondly, I hate to give the other side, if you want to call them that, some ideas, but if going through the courts is not the proper way to get acceptance of an idea. When you go through the courts, you usurp the democratic process and you make people very upset and they feel like they've been denied representation. They go and they throw tea over the side of the ship in Boston. That's what happens when you get people telling you what to do and without going through the proper channels of the law and through your elected representative. And so I would encourage you that if you do want to see change in the political system, and if you want to see change in the law, that you contact your representative and you let them know, or better yet, you run for office on these issues. Because that is how law should be changed, and not through the court system. And when you go through the court system, I don't think anybody can disagree about how contentious America has been since 1973 when Roe v. Wade was handed down. Roe v. Wade is a horrible decision. And part of the reason why we have such a splintered nation is because it was enforced on the people from the judges and from the courts. And so I think that does not help civil debate. It hurts it.
You're obviously not the father of a young woman that was butchered by an alley doctor. You certainly have no understanding that women in America deserve the right to appropriate reproductive health care. You obviously don't understand issues that are of such critical importance to the American public, because you're blinded by your faith.
Pedro, this time I'm right.
Oh. It was a great answer anyway.
But you're second. By agreement, we're now going to have each party to wrap up their thoughts and provide some final reflections on these issues. They'll each have a maximum of 5 minutes to do so. Joel?
Well, it's been a long evening, and I know you're all tired, and I hear there's a reception, and I don't think we're being paid by the hour, so there's no sense in keeping our billing clock running. But there are a couple thoughts I'd like to leave you with, and that is this issue. If you are the homosexual persuasion and you exhibit homosexual behavior, you can have kids. There are ways to do that in this day and age. You can live together. You can live together in the privacy of your home. You can live together in the public sphere of the restaurants and the public square. You can engage in as much free speech as you want, and the Constitution will protect your right to engage in that free speech. You have the right to contract with one another. You have the right to a reciprocal benefits contract. Even in Kansas, you have that right, and that will not be denied to you. You have the right to enter into a will where you leave all of your possessions to your significant other. You have a right to enter into medical directives that allows for your partner to visit you in the hospital. None of these rights are being denied you. You have these legal rights today under the law. You have the right to gain employment. In fact, one needs to go to the Fortune 500 companies of the world and see how protected those rights are and the employment practices that they have. In fact, the per capita wealth of people who exhibit homosexual behavior is higher than the heterosexual per capita income. There is, all this being said, what are we talking about then? What are we talking about? We're talking about changing the definition of marriage. Let's just be honest about it. That's what we're talking about. We want to change the definition of marriage. If you can come up and give me one example of where homosexual marriage was the law, that's fine. That's one example. But are you saying that's going to even pale into comparison to the other thousands of examples of throughout the history of time where marriage has only been between a man and a woman? They want to change the definition of marriage. They're not seeking equal rights. And so since they have this right, since they have the right to marry now, what they want is the right to change the definition of marriage, and that is what they do not have the constitutional right to do. And again, the most important issue that I want to leave you with today is that the who decides the question. This is a very significant issue. And I don't think anybody here, no matter what side of the issue that you were on, the important thing is that who has the right to decide what marriage is. Do a couple judges get to decide it for everybody? Do the people get to decide? And I say it is the people who get to decide what marriage is, and that is the proper avenue to go through if you want to change the institution of marriage. Thank you.
Do me a favor. If you are homosexual or transgender, and you feel comfortable in doing so, would you please stand? If you have a family member who's homosexual and you feel comfortable, would you please stand? If you have a friend that's homosexual, would you please stand? There's your answer, Mr. Oster. There's your answer. I'm a trial lawyer, Mr. Oster. I don't get tired. And I will defend the right of all of these good people against those like you who preach on ignorance, who spread hate. Take a look in Topeka at Fred Phelps. Take a look at what that type of control means. We will someday overcome. You will someday be treated equally. And the shame of your treatment will be on the shoulders of all of us that lived through it. And I am sorry that you have to go through this. I know some of you, my dear friend Lynn, whose brother died in her arms, not going to the doctor because he was ashamed of being homosexual. My client, Sandy Gast, who was arrested, taken to jail, strip searched, and made to shower in front of male officers as a transgender woman simply because she signed a marriage application as the wife. We have to stop this insanity. We have to love one another more than we dislike one another. I was fortunate to be the president of the Kansas Trial Lawyers in the year 2001. It was indeed a space odyssey. And I was at the Capitol building one day. I had gone there to testify on a bill. And Governor Carlin, you'll get a kick out of this. As I'm walking through the second floor of the rotunda, by the rotunda, a group of about 100 children, maybe in seventh grade, were walking in my direction. And their teacher said, "What do we do from here?" I was wearing a suit. I looked old. I obviously had authority. And I said, "Follow me." And I had them lined the rotunda. And I said, "Kids, this is a house of freedom. This is a house of liberty. On the count of three, I want you at the top of your lungs to scream the word freedom." And sure enough, when I said three, those 100 voices in unison screamed, "Freedom!" And it reverberated through the dome. Guards came running from every part of the building. But I knew I wasn't going to be arrested for screaming freedom or telling the kids to scream. Then, not long ago, Grace Cathedral invited me to speak at their 4th of July. And I did the same thing with them. And with you tonight, before we go, would you please stand? And with me, all of you, please, just stand. And at the count of three, in this alumni center, please join me in, at the top of your lungs, screaming the word freedom. 1, 2, 3. Freedom! Freedom! Thank you, Kansas State.